أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد. أفضل صلواتك بعدد معلوماتك وبارك وسلم وصل عليه. سورة فضل. As we mentioned before, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going to Mecca to perform Umrah along with 1400 Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. And that was in the month of Zulqadah, year number 6. The people of Mecca, they have restricted Muslims to enter to Mecca, but unofficially. It was not declared, but they were not allowing them to come to Mecca and to perform their ibadah. Now when he was going, so the people of Mecca, they were in hot water now. What should be done? How we can stop him not to enter to Mecca? And number two, their confusion was that they are in the form of Ihram and month is the month of Zulqadah, which is called the sacred month. So if we will stop and prevent them, it will bring a bad name to the people of Mecca. That what are you doing? Against international law. Got it? But if they entered to Mecca, 1400 people from our enemies who defeated us in Badr, in the Uhud, in the Battle of Trench, and if they will enter in such a way, so another message will go to the entire world that now people of Mecca are no more there to counter Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Got it? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent someone to get information there from that what they are doing and planning. He came back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told him that Quraysh, they are well prepared in a place on the freeway towards Mecca. The place is called Zitua. Zitua. Z-I-T-U-W-A. And 200 horse riders under the leadership of Khalid ibn Walid, they are coming towards another place called Quraqul Ghamim. Quraqul Ghamim. And this strategy of the people of Mecca was to irritate Muslims, to start something other way around, so they may have an excuse that these people were not coming for worship, but they were terrorists. They were coming here to spread the disturbance and turmoil. Got it? You should write the same word, and then you may apply here, everywhere and anywhere. History repeats itself. Yes? To avoid untoward situation, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam changed the freeway. He took an exit from the freeway and he went all the way towards the beach on Mediterranean. Now look, this is the straight freeway from Medina to Mecca. Look here. This is the freeway from Medina to Mecca. Here in Quraqul Ghamim,
Khalid along with 200 riders. Here another big group of Quraysh, they were on the freeway in the mountain to irritate Muslims in one way or the other. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took an exit here from to the right.
Where?
To the right, and went all the way to the Mediterranean. And coming along the beach towards Jannah. Towards, here is Jannah. And here is Mecca. It was a very difficult way towards Mecca. When Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to a place, nowadays known by the name of Ash-Shumaisi.
What?
When you had come out of Jannah airport, so some 10 miles after that, or 11, 12 miles after that, you will see a signboard Ash-Shumaisi. So to walk your left from the nowadays freeway, there is the place which is called the Hudaybiyah.
What?
Hudaybiyah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to that Hudaybiyah, which does not have the same name now. Now it is called? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it a rest area. He stopped there. The chief of Banu Khuzaha, a well-known tribe of the area, its chief, his name is Budail ibn Warqa.
Budail
ibn Warqa. He came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam along with a few other people. And he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the purpose of your coming? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Umrah only. He went back to the people of Quraysh. He tried to his best to make them to understand that let them come to Mecca to perform their ibadat and their worship. Because that is against the charter of UNO of that time. Unwritten.
What?
Yes. Lot of laws. Almost 80% of 80% of laws, these are unwritten.
Yes?
That is in the mind of general public. Even though the Britain does not have a written constitution.
It has.
There is no written constitution in Britain. But the same constitution is known to every single individual in Britain. And that's why the government cannot violate it.
The government cannot
violate it. Because everybody knows that what constitution is and what are the requirements of constitution.
Got it?
So same is the case of well-known laws. It doesn't need to be written. That is written here in the brain and mind of every single individual. So he told them, let them come to perform their ibadah. It's against rules and laws, human norms, values, religious freedom, freedom of religion. But they said no. So then, the chief of Ahabish, chief of Ahadish. Ahadish is the plural of Ahbash. His name was Hadith ibn Al-Qama. He came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on behalf of the people of Quraysh to convince him to go back.
To convince him?
To go back. And by doing so, the people of Mecca, they thought that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will never accept it. He will never accept it. And the Ahabish and their leader, he will make it a matter of ego. He will make it a matter of ego. So they both will start fighting each other. He will get rid of him. These are strategies.
Got it or not? And in this case, a hadith will support and help us. Yes. But when he came, and the way Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke to him, so he was convinced. And he went back to Quraysh, back while. But he went up, are you crazy? All of them, they are in a haram. They have 70 camels to sacrifice them. You know what I'm saying? They do not have any heavy weapons. As far as the case of sword is concerned, that's a part of culture. That's not a weapon. That's not considered. As I mentioned, that Klashenkov in Pashtun area is not considered weapon. That's a part of rest. Yes. Even though that is the dangerous ever rifle all over the world. Yes. That is the dangerous ever. You cannot find any other dangerous small weapon than Klashenkov. But anyhow, now that has become a part of Pashtun culture. Got it? So somebody who will be riding a donkey cart but having the flash and cloth hanging to his right arm left shoulder. You know, came to the people of Makkah and he told them that we will never help and support you in something which is wrong. Then after that, the chief of Banu Saqif from Taif, his name is Urwa ibn Mas'ud. He tried to his best to convince Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go back. But Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, look, do we have any weapon to fight? Are we crazy? Coming days far from Medina, having no weapons with us, and we'll be fighting with swords only. And look at our dress. Do we have our own dress or we are in a haram? He said, in a haram. He said, then what are these camels having this ilaba in their neck? He said, they are slaughtered. Sacrificed animals. He said, what do you think? He said, yes, I came to know. That you don't have any bad intention. You are here having a very good and noble intention. That is the ibadah. And nobody has any right to stop you. And at that time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was making wudu for prayer. What? Wudu for prayer. Look, one sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was having a, what he called, lota? Huh? Or any part. A part of water. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was making wudu. Look, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put water in his mouth, rinsed it. And when he was throwing it, Sahaba Rizwanullahi wa Alim Ajma'in, they were holding their dresses, their hands, yes, and their kameez and shirt, to take the water of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to rub it on their body. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was washing his face. They were holding their hands here, their dress here, yes, not to let it go to the ground. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was washing his feet and they were taking the water as a blessing. They were taking the usala as a blessing. So Urwa ibn Mas'ud, he went back to the people of Makkah. He said, look, number one, they are in a haram. Number two, they have sacrificial animals with them. Number three, they do not have any weapons. That is their intention. That is their, it means they don't have any bad intention. So you may not stop them. And number four, to fight with these guys, that's a suicide. To fight with these guys, that's suicide. You are trying to get rid of Muhammad. So these 1400 fighters who are surrounding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how you will approach Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when they are there? Because I saw them. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was washing his body and they were taking every single drop of that barakah. So they will allow you to touch the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know what I'm saying? You are living in full paradise. Yes? Where you are living?
the fool's paradise.
And he said, "My God, at the tip of my big tribe, I have been with so many kings. I have never seen such a respect of any king all over the world as the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are giving to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So once, at night, 40 or 50 people of Quraysh, at night, they threw arrows on the tents of Sahaba and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also stones. Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhi wa sallam caught them. These 40 or 50 people of Quraysh and brought them to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, "Look, we are in ihram. We are for Umrah. So that's why we cannot retaliate. And we can't say anything to you people." Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did like this. Go. He released them. Another place which is called Tanghim. And there is a big masjid known by the name of Masjid al-Tanghim. Also Masjid Aisha. Where from those who are in need of Umrah, they do make Ihram their farm and they perform Umrah. Tanghim. So at the time of Fajr prayer, they attacked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his followers. They were caught by Sahaba as well. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after giving them a few words, he released them also. "Just go back. Yes, don't try to retake us. Because we can't do anything. We are in a haram. We are in a haram." And then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he thought a strategy. He sent Uthman radiyallahu ta'ala an to speak to the people of Makkah and to make it clear to them that we are here only for Umrah, nothing else. And why Uthman, not Abu Bakr, Umar al-Ali, Rizwanullahi alayhim ajma'in? Because their tribe, the tribe of Abu Bakr, the tribe of Umar and the tribe of Ali, mostly they believed in the message of Muhammad and migrated to Medina. But the tribe of Uthman, Umayyad, who? Umayyad. They were still in Makkah. And not only in Makkah, they were considered the chieftains of Makkah. Yes? And as you know, that in tribal area, maybe the guy is not known to you, but the moment he will introduce himself, that I am Hasan Khair. What I am? Hasan Khair. Then Fahim will never think that he is on the right side or on the wrong side. But he is Hasan Khair, he must be supported. If anybody will touch him, he will face the consequences. That's the nature of the tribal system. Yes, Professor? Yes? So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a strategy, he sent to Allah radiyallahu ta'ala an that nobody can harm him. Why? Because his tribe, they are living here in Makkah. You know what I'm saying? Otherwise, people who can stop Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from ibadah and worship, they can do anything. They can do anything because these people, they don't have any character. You know what I'm saying? So they can kill the messenger also. Yes? The ambassador also. The initiative also. But if there is a reservation, and that reservation is, oh, if we will touch him, what about Umayyad? Abu Sufyan will attack us. Who will attack us? Abu Sufyan, the chief of Makkah, he will attack us. And he will burn us. He will burn us. That, oh, you people touched my cousin? Are you crazy? Got it? So Uthman radiallahu ta'ala, and number two, Uthman by nature, he was very kind and very soft. And Hadith Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that everybody will be having a neighbor in Jannah. And my neighbor beside my house will be Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu ta'ala. What a status. What a position. Then my neighbor will be who? The immediate neighbor will be Uthman radiyallahu ta'ala. So now the people of Mecca, they stopped Uthman there in Mecca. He could not make or made a return to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the appointed time. So then he could not come back in the appointed time. The people stopped him not to go. Yes, let's discuss this. Let's make a way out. You know what I'm saying? So here, the rumors were spreading that Uthman is killed. Uthman is killed. It was a rumor. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he got informed and heard the rumor, he addressed the Sahaba Rizwanullah alayhim ajma'in, that I heard and you as well, that Uthman is killed. If the news is right and true, then I will take a revenge. Because Uthman was not there for his personal business. He was on behalf of the Messenger of Allah and the head of the Islamic State. You know what I'm saying? Official business. So I am bound to take his revenge. So these 14 Sahaba Rizwanullah alayhim ajma'in, every one of them, they said, Ta'muruna wa nufta. No, O the Messenger of Allah, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is not the case. Yes, you will give us an indication only, and then you will see what type of sacrifice will be present. Got it? You will not take any mind. We are there. Got it? How Islam spreads all over the world? Muhammad had such like companions. Muhammad had such like companions. Rizwanullah alayhi wa sallam. Professor, this was the case of Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they said that we are not just like the companions of Moses. Alayhi salatu wa sallam. When he asked them to go to the holy land, so they said, Fathab anta wa rabbuka maqatila. You and your brother can go and fight them. Inna hauna ta'idun, we will be waiting here for some good news. The companion said, we will be waiting here for some good news. Sahaba said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are not like the companions of Musa. You will give us a small indication, then you will see. You know what I'm saying? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became that much happy. And Allah as well. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to take a new pleasure of these people. And that pleasure caused the pleasure of pleasure. The pleasure of pleasure. Bayatul Rizwan. Bayatul Rizwan. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is fear. لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ That I fear. Allah said, I fear that I am very much happy with these people. Allah says, I fear that I am very much happy with these people. If you buy Hunaka, Sakta Shagara, when you were leaning to a tree and they were giving you a pledge. A pledge of what? That was a pledge of death. Or that was a pledge on death. That was a pledge on death. Then yes, they are very much ready for death. Got it? Professor, you got it or you got it? That is good. Later on, Uthman came back and brought Suhail ibn Amr. Suhail ibn Amr, he was a poet. He was an orator. He was a table talker. He was what? A table talker. In table talk, nobody was able to defeat him. Suhail ibn Amr. He was victorious everywhere. You know what I'm saying? So whenever the people of Makkah, they were sending someone, so they used to send this guy, Suhail ibn Amr, to talk to him. So Suhail ibn Amr came. And eventually, a pact or a treaty took place. Pact, P-A-C-T. It took place which is called in history the Pact of Hudaybiyah. Sulh Hudaybiyah or Pact of Hudaybiyah. Sayyidina Ali radiyallahu ta'ala an, he was writing. So as usual he wrote, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the beneficent and the merciful. Suhail ibn Amr said, no, don't write this. Said, why? He said, we believe in Allah as Allah, but we do not believe that he is Rahman ar-Rahim as well. You do not believe that he is Rahman ar-Rahim as well. And why? Because he had a very good excuse in this regard. You know what I'm saying? And that is, there are so many Rahman and Rahim, everybody has in Makkah in his own house. Yes. Everybody has so many Rahman and Rahim. Yes. But if you will believe in this Allah is Rahman and Rahim, so our God, they are jobless then. Did you got it? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Ali radiallahu ta'ala wa lakum so, erase it. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? What? Erase it. So Ali did, he erased it. So now, the starting was, Bismillah. What was? In the name of Allah. And that's enough. When it is said Allah, so he has all his qualities. No matter. Somebody is believing in or he does not. But when he is Allah, so he is the beneficent, he is the merciful, he is the Ghaffar, he is the Qahhar, he is the Sattar, he is the Jalal al Ikram, this, 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 this. Got it or not? Then the second line, هذا ما اتفق عليه محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وسهيل بن عمرو. That is the treaty or the condition or the article whereupon Muhammad the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Suhail ibn Amr agreed. When Ali wrote it, he showed it to Suhail. Because headings are known. Headings are treaty. This is known. That the party name should be there. Party's name should be there. Who represents this party and their party? Its name. So he wrote it. So again, Suhail ibn Amr says, no, you do not believe in Muhammad as messenger of Allah. And you wrote it in the paper. Later on when I will sign it, so it means that I admitted that he is the messenger of Allah, and I do not. Then not me, my people, they do not believe in his message. Got it? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked to Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, to erase it. To erase it. But Ali radiallahu ta'ala an who said, Akarrat hulisani, my gun uttered and expressed that you are the messenger of Allah. Wa saddaqathu jalani, my heart believed in your message that you are the messenger of Allah. Wa katabathu banani, and my finger wrote it that you are the messenger of Allah. Got it? So he never said that I am not going to erase it. That was against the other way in the respect of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say no to. Got it? So now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to know that he will never erase it. So he offered his gift to me. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, he erased the word Rasulullah. The word Rasulullah. And he told him, write down Ibn Abdullah. هذا ما اتفق عليه محمد بن عبد الله وسهيل بن عمرو. That is the treaty of the pact whereupon محمد صنع عبد الله and سهيل صنع عمر agreed. Got it? Can you bring such an example all over the world in human history? They, a king or a ruler that much powerful as Muhammad was sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who defeated this type of enemy yes so many times, and they were unable even to counter him anywhere, but he was listening to every single demand of their representative, because he wants to give a message of peace to the whole world. yes? And a Britisher, he has written a book in the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, when he is talking about the Mecca of Arabia, and he spoke about these two, three things, so he said that in fact that he was an angel of peace. He was an angel of peace. Then after the article number one, that this treaty will be for 10 years, that none of the parties will harm each other openly or secretly. Openly or secretly. Number two, their allies who will agree this treaty, they would be considered as a part of it. They would be considered a part of it. Number three, this time Muhammad and his people will go back without Umrah. Next year they can come, having with them only swords and nothing else. They can stay at Mecca for 3 days and nights. And the people of Mecca will go out of Mecca for those 3 days and nights. So no any untoward incident may take place. Got it? Number four. Whosoever will go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking for political asylum from the people of Mecca, he must be returned back. He must be returned back. But not the vice versa. If somebody will run away from the people of Medina to Mecca, so he must not be returned there. Got it? And this was the article which was unacceptable to 1400 Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. Only Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed it from the very beginning. And Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala an and others, they were not very much ready to accept it. Got it? But nobody was able to speak out. Except Umar radiallahu ta'ala on his shoulder. And he brought out his sword. And he said, no way. What is this? And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just allow us to fight. Yes. Just allow us to fight. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Ya Umar, Subhadam. So Umar is going to say. Now the treaty was signed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and by Suhail ibn Amr. Now anyway they had to go back and to take themselves out of their ihram. Got it? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sahaba, they slaughter your animals. Slaughter your animals. Shave or trim your head. Take off your ihram. Take a shower. Be ready to go back. Nobody moved from his place. Otherwise, the same Sahaba and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only wished for something, so they jumped. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, here he addressed, and nobody moved. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became upset. And he came to his friends. In this trip of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our mother Ummu Salama, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she was accompanying Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was inside the tent. Who? Umm Salama. Prophet said, Umm Salama, She said, yes. Said, look what happened to my companions. They are the 10 people who are sacrificing themselves. But now when I address them, nobody moves. Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala told him, they are in shock. There were 10 people in shock. They do not understand what you are saying. When they are in shock, they never understood that what you are telling them. You know what I'm saying? That they are thinking something else. That what happened to us? Why we are trapped here? Why we are not allowed to perform Umrah? And why they imposed this article on us? Why they have ordered us to go back? Are they upper hand? No. We are the upper hand. We have defeated them several times. But why they have done it to us? So they are in shock. So he asked Umm Salama, what should I do now? The Prophet asked Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, asked who? Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, his wife and our mother. What should I do now? So she told Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, they don't tell them anything. Because in such like situation, words will never work. Action will work. Words will never work. Action will work. Prophet asked her, what do you mean? She said, that you should slaughter your own camel. Yes? Shave your head. Take off your ihram. Yes? And take a shower. And then just pass by them. Don't say anything to them. And Rasulullah did the same. When he passed by Sahaba, they were sitting here and here under the trees and to the rocks and to the mountains and things like that. You know what I'm saying? So when they saw Rasulullah, that he is no more in ihram. Yes? And his hair is shaved. Yes? And he has taken off his ihram. So they rushed like pigs to slaughter their animals. And Rasulullah became very much happy. And he said, Umm Salama, what a good advice you have given me. That is? Because in such like situation, in such like situation, the words will never work. What will work? Action will work. Yes or not? Say yes or not? And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when the treaty was done, he came to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala to his friend. Look, he was in a big shock. You should write it. Umar came to Abu Bakr to his friend. And he said, Abu Bakr, he said, yes. Is Muhammad the messenger of Allah? He said, of course he is. Then he asked the second question. Are we Muslims and believers? He said, of course we are. You understand? The third question. Do we follow the truth? He said, of course. Do you think our enemies, they are on the wrong side? He said, of course. So I said, then why we accepted these conditions? Got it? Abu Bakr told him very brief, he is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever he does, that is good. Whatever he does, he is the messenger of Allah. But Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he was in that much big shock that he came out of the tent of Abu Bakr and went to the tent of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting there. He said, As-salatu wa salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. He said, wa alayka as-salam. Tafaddal ya ibn al-Khattab. How are you doing? So he asked the same question. Are you not the messenger of Allah? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, I am. Yes. And Prophet was appreciating Umar for this question. That is his meaning, his strong character. He said, are you not the messenger of Allah? He said, of course I am. He said, are we not the Muslims and believers? He said, yes. He said, are we not on the right side? He said, yes, we are. Are our enemy not on the wrong side? He said, yes. So why we accepted this humiliation? This humiliation. Yes, to return to them, their wanted and not to return to us, our wanted. And to tell us, go back and next year you will come and for 3 days and night and giving us suggestions. Got it? Or not? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he answered the same answer to that, I am the messenger of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever I do, that is the order of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar came back to his tent. He thought for a while and then he started crying. And he was addressing himself, Umar, are you crazy? Huh? You spoke to the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and stay at home? Are you crazy? You are going to lose your iman and your belief? You are going to destroy your dunya and akhirah? And Umar says, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, after this, whenever I had time, so I used to pray nafal. And whenever I had something, I used to donate it and to give as a charity. And the only dua I was making that, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive me for that irrespective of mine to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even though Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conferred him 10 times, that Umar, no problem. Yes, your feelings were appreciated. Your feelings are? Say, appreciated. Yes, because there are two types of people. If you will have only the people of one single nation, all of them stopped. So everything is gone. Everything is, but you should have soft, yes, soft-hearted people like Dr. Parveen or Fahim. And you should have the people of strong character like Bilal and Hafiz Ahmed. Yes? So Brother Parveen and Brother Bilal, they will talk to people nicely. Yes, and Brother Bilal and Hafiz Ahmed, they will say that, do you want to stop it or do you want to be thrown 118? Yes? So in the same way, the institution will run smoothly. Otherwise not. Got it? Got it or not? So Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that all my life long, I was doing charity, praying a lot of nafal, fasting a lot, that oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tone I used at that time, that was a disrespect to the messenger of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Got it? At the same time, when now the treaty was taking place and not been signed yet, the son of Suhail ibn Amr, you should write it. His name is Abu Jundub. He accepted Islam and he was tied at home with chains, fetters in his feet and chains in his hands. He came out of his house, yes, used any means, and came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His father was sitting here. And he said, oh, the messenger of Allah, I am a Muslim, this is my father. He chained me with fetters, with these chains. I broke it. I came out. And I will go with you. I don't want to stay here in Makkah anymore. They are torturing me. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam consoled him. He said, yes. Inshallah. So Suhail ibn Amr, he said, no, that's against the treaty. You cannot take him with you because it is militant there. That our wanted must be returned. Our wanted must be returned. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that Suhail, you are a very clever man. Now, as long as the treaty is not signed, neither me nor you are bound to follow the cultural article. Got it? Look, because it has not become binding. It will become binding when? When we will sign. Yes, 12, 11. Duty signed what time? 12, 11. So on 12, 10, that's not a binding treaty. 12, 11, they will become what? A binding one. But Suhail said that no, if you will not accept it, then I'm not going to sign it. I'm not going to sign it. So Abu Jundal was given back to Suhail. Got it? God is omnipotent. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was going back to Medina. So the same place where Khalid ibn Walid with 200 people, they were waiting for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to instigate them or to irritate them. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam approached the same place going back to Medina, Quraahul Ghamim, what? The place name is Quraahul Ghamim. So he received this surah there. Jibreel Amin came there, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his way with 1400 sahaba towards Medina, and Jibreel Amin came, inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. That was a great guiding by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have given you a manifest victory, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So obviously, that is not a victory, that's a defeat. That we were unable to perform our umrah, and that's a victory. Yes, that is a victory. Because up until this time, they were not accepting you as a community. Yes, they were calling you the wanted people, the criminals, the terrorists. So today, they approve your status. Today, the people of Makkah, but they recognize your state now. That's why they did a treaty case. This is the first ever time that they were there to say, they recognize your state and your status. Yes, that Medina is a state, Muhammad is the head of state. Yes, Medina is a state and Muhammad is the head of state. This is a visible victory. This is an obvious and manifest victory. Number one. And number two, you should write it. This is a victory. When the leader or the imam said march, so his followers start march. And when he says stop, so they stop. When the leader says about turn or make a new turn, so they make a new turn. And nobody has any reservation. Nobody has any reservation. So certain conditions from this treaty, these were not acceptable even to a common layman. But your Sahaba, they accepted it from A to Z, that is a victory. Yes, and a leader needs such like followers. A leader needs such like followers. If a leader will have such like followers, nobody will be able to counter him or to compete him. وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى اصحابه اجمعين. اللهم ارحمنا بالقران العظيم، اللهم ذكرنا بالقران ما نسينا، وعلمنا من ما جهلنا.